Today we're talking about cell phones, the most efficient way to send memes to your friends and the NSA. Aitken has your personal information? So why are we talking about this today? Well, because the Supreme Court just ruled in the case of Carpenter versus United States, and one of the biggest victories for privacy since the invention of the door. Alright, that might be a bit of an exaggeration, but I'm honestly a little surprised this case went the way it did. Because generally, when it comes to our data, I feel like the government doesn't want to take away the government's power to government. But in this case, it happened. So what was this case? Well, I did cover the oral arguments. Today, we are talking about a doozy of a case. Carpenter versus United States. Now, generally, I think it's sweet when someone cares enough about me to want to know where I am. But not when it's the federal government. Come on, government. You can't just keep track of people without even getting a warrant. That's Facebook's job. So today we're looking at the exciting conclusion to the case of Carpenter versus United States. And quick thing, I literally could not find one news report talking about this decision. So I'm only going to be able to cut away to text. Which we all know isn't as fun as Action 5 News and cutting to Wolf Blitzer's breaking news story when, don't worry buddy, we've all been aware that the news has been broken for a while now. So first, what happened? Well, to quote Justice Roberts' opinion, in 2010, police officers arrested four men suspected of robbing a series of Radio Shacks and, ironically enough, T-Mobile stores in Detroit. Thank you for pointing out the irony, but that's my job. Also, robbing a T-Mobile store? Really? I mean, T-Mobile's probably the only company where, if you steal from them, you'll still lose your shirt by the time the first bill comes. Hey, at least the government might not be able to keep track of you because their plans don't give you service anywhere. So anyways, these guys were robbing from Radio Shacks and T-Mobiles in a crime spree that's more 2010 than the idea of Democrats having hope. One of the robbers confessed and identified 15 of his accomplices, including getaway drivers. The FBI reviewed those numbers and their call records to gain additional phone calls made during the crime. They then applied for court orders under the Stored Communications Act to obtain cell phone records for a petitioner, Timothy Carpenter. So far, legally speaking, the government is all good, despite the fact that this reads like one of the more boring George Orwell books. Here's where you get into trouble though, because the Shared Communications Act I just mentioned allows the government to compel private cell phone companies to hand over telecommunications data and records. In this case, cell site sector information from Carpenter's telephone at call origination and call termination for incoming and outgoing calls during the 4-month period when the string of robberies occurred. They got all that data, which included 12,898 location points cataloging Carpenter's movements, an average of 101 data points per day. Man, do I feel sorry for that poor kid who thought, hey, a summer internship working for data at the FBI. That'll be fun. So anyways, they got a massive amount of location data on this guy, and were able to bring him in on 6 counts of robbery and 6 counts of carrying a firearm during a federal crime of violence. Because they were able to pinpoint his location to the scene of 6 of those crimes. Only problem, as Carpenter pointed out, his 4th Amendment rights were violated because those records had been obtained without a warrant supported by probable cause. Think less probable cause and more 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon crime edition. Because, hey, this guy called a guy who the suspect named as an accomplice, let strong arm his cell phone provider into giving us 4 months of his location data. So instead of getting my opinion on the Constitution, let's see what the justices said. The justice who wrote the decisive opinion, Justice Roberts, had to balance 2 pieces of legal precedence in this decision. First, a person traveling in an automobile on public thoroughfares has no reasonable expectation of privacy in his movements from one place to another, since the movements of the vehicle and its final destination have been voluntarily conveyed to anyone who wanted to look. So yeah, if I'm walking around and someone sees me walking around and says, hey, that guy's walking around, I can't turn around and accuse that guy of spying on me. Now, that's an oversimplification, and this has been used to excuse some pretty things. Specifically, the government's use of a beeper to aid in tracking a vehicle through traffic. That said, they had put that tracking beeper into a jar of chloroform and tracked the guy to a cabin in Wisconsin. And no one's buying chloroform and bringing it to a cabin because they're about to win a Nobel Peace Prize. This goes back to the whole idea of reasonable expectation of privacy, though, because it was later decided, in United States vs. Jones, FBI agents installed a GPS tracking device on Jones' vehicle and remotely monitored the vehicle's movements for 28 days. It was decided that, in most cases, longer-term GPS monitoring and investigations of offenses infringes on an expectation of privacy. Don't you just love how subjective our surveillance laws are? It really seems that if something makes the justices reach for their tinfoil hats, that violates reasonable expectations of privacy. Otherwise, carry on. Now, the second set of legal precedents the Supreme Court had to deal with was the idea of third parties, because the court previously held that a person has no legitimate expectation of privacy in information he voluntarily turns over to third parties, which basically means that the government can get your information from a private company without setting off Fourth Amendment protections. When applied to phones, though, it was said that the government's use of a pen registrar, a device that recorded the outgoing phone numbers dialed on a landline telephone, was not a search. Noting that the pen registrar's limited capabilities, the court doubted that people in general entertained any actual expectation of privacy in the numbers they dial. Not sure who the reasonable person is, but man, does he have some low expectations. So the question is, how do you apply these rules about landline phones and tracking technology from the Starsky and Hutch era, where it was less global positioning satellites and more just Sputnik floating around, to the cell phones that give the government near-perfect surveillance and allow it to travel back in time to retrace a person's whereabouts, subject only to the 5-year retention policies of most wireless carriers? So, the Supreme Court did a few things. First, it declined to extend Smith and Miller to cover these novel circumstances. Now, Smith and Miller was the case we talked about where the government was tracking outgoing calls made from a private phone. Totally fine, but you can't track someone's location from their phone because an individual maintains a legitimate expectation of privacy in the record of his physical movements as captured through cell-site location information. Or, in layman's terms, that's just too damn creepy, government. Now, criminals, before you put down that match and wipe the gasoline off your phone, just know that the location information obtained from Carpenter's wireless carriers was the product of a search. That means that rather than the government can't do this, it just means that the government needs a reason to do it that's more rock solid than, I wonder where Brendan Fraser went after those Mummy movies. By requiring a warrant. This ruling did explicitly leave open some questions, in a tune in next time sort of way, by saying, "We do neither express a view on matters not before us, real-time location tracking, or tower dumps, a download of information on all the devices that are connected to a particular cell site during a particular interview." I smell a sequel! Now, Justice Kennedy was not a big fan of all this, and wrote the dissenting opinion. And I'm surprised he didn't start his argument by citing, "When I was your age, us young whippersnappers weren't connected with the new gadgets and gizmos. The government couldn't track our tin cans and string." Nope, instead, he made an argument that this was not about location tracking, but about how this was all obtaining business information. The court has twice held that individuals have no Fourth Amendment interests in business records which are possessed, owned, and controlled by a third party. Which, that sounds pretty open-ended. Can you clarify? When the government uses a subpoena to obtain, for example, bank records, telephone records, and credit cards from the businesses that create and keep those records, the government does not engage in a search of the business's customers within the meaning of the Fourth Amendment. Briefly, they didn't need a warrant for that? Sorry, I have to change the on-file credit cards for a few accounts. Also, while we're on the subject, reasonable person here, that's a little beyond my expectation of privacy, which apparently is important to you guys. This is where it gets to the part where I'm actually kind of surprised that the outcome was the way it was, Because, as Kennedy points out, the petitioner acknowledges that the government may obtain a wide variety of business records using compulsory progress, and he does not ask the court to revisit its precedences. Yes, he argues that, under the same precedences, the government searched his records when it used court-approved compulsory methods to obtain the cell site information at issue here. Okay, this is really strange, because what that means is that you have no problem with the overall scope of not needing a warrant to get third-party information. And even more, you don't think that the investigations actually did anything wrong. You just think that this process should not apply to historic cell site location tracking, because it gives you a bad feeling in your stomach? Essentially, Kennedy thinks that these location tracking services should be treated like just the rest of your information. To go even further, he emphasizes that, among other things, providers aggregate the records and sell them to third parties along with other information gleaned from cell phone usage. So, cell phone carriers can sell your location to other companies. Now I know what's so private about the private sector. So, there you have it. The government can't track your previous locations using cell phones unless they have a warrant. Moral of the story? If you're gonna commit a crime, just leave your phone at home, alright? You're not that important. You can call them back later. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism investigating the Supreme Court, subscribe to our YouTube channel for our weekly Supreme Court Saturday episodes. Click here if you want to see an in-depth analysis of the case that led to this decision, and click here to see an episode that YouTube, if I'm being completely honest, probably used data from your cell phone and email to recommend to you. Thanks for watching, and as always, leave a comment if you think you have an important case that I should research.